Greetings and grace and peace to you all in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We're glad that you could join us for this recorded service of River Oaks Reformed Presbyterian Church. As a reminder, if you have any pastoral needs during this time, you're more than welcome to contact our pastoral staff or your shepherding elder, and we'd be happy to assist you however we are able. Our call to worship for this service comes from Psalm 113, which says, "Praise the Lord. Praise, O servants of the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. From the rising of the sun to its setting, the name of the Lord be praised. The Lord is high above all nations, and his glory above the heavens. Who is like the Lord our God, who is seated on high, who looks far down on the heavens and the earth?" Well, as we approach the Lord in worship, and as we reflect upon his character and his holiness, we're reminded of our own sinfulness and our need for cleansing. So as our confession of sin, I'll read these words, which come from the Puritan prayer book, Piercing Heaven. "Dear Emmanuel, in whom alone and by whom alone all my hopes and confidences are founded, I fall down at your feet. As the prophet cried out, so I desire unceasingly to exclaim, I am a man of unclean lips. But if you cause the iniquity to be taken away, and my sin to be purged from me, I will be clean. For you are our New Testament altar. You are the Lord my righteousness. Precious Jesus, you are the Alpha and Omega. Even as the Father made you the glorious covenant head of your people in the beginning of his way, so be my all in all, my first and last, the author and finisher of my faith. Precious Lord, may I, like Paul, be able to say, not as though I had already attained, because I long to catch up to and hold fast to you, Christ Jesus, even as you have caught up to and held fast to me. So come, Lord Jesus, to your bride, the church. Be the fountain of life to all your redeemed, until you bring your church below to join your church above, so they will dwell together in the light of your countenance forever. Amen." Hear now these words of assurance of pardon, which come from Isaiah chapter 1, verse 18. "Come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool." I invite you now to sing with us the words of the hymn, "Wonderful, Merciful Savior."
Adore.
Well, for this service, I'm continuing a series on the book of James, which I've been occasionally preaching through for our morning services. So our text today comes from James chapter 3, verses 13 through 18. Now, you could probably make the case that this passage accurately summarizes the theme of the book as a whole. Of all the books of the New Testament, James comes closest to what we would call wisdom literature. So that puts it in a class with Old Testament books like Proverbs and Ecclesiastes. In this passage, James urges believers to walk in wisdom in such a way that others can see our conduct. So this very much lines up with the main point of his previous chapter, that faith without works is dead. Notice the parallel here between faith and wisdom. Both of these qualities claimed to be possessed by professing Christians can exist in two forms. There's the genuine form, and there's the counterfeit form. The genuine form is the mark of a true believer, while the counterfeit form is a mark of a hypocrite. And the genuineness of both faith and wisdom is discerned by the fruit that they produce in the believer's life. Now, the question of how to walk in wisdom is probably weighing heavy on all of us right now. As we experience the disruptions to our lives caused by this novel coronavirus, we're all asking ourselves, how do Christians act wisely, especially during a time of crisis and uncertainty? Well, I'm sure that many of you have already been reading plenty of sources about washing your hands and social distancing and flattening the curve. And there is wisdom in all of that advice. But that's not exactly the kind of wisdom that James is primarily talking about here. James is instead speaking about a deeper spiritual wisdom, which sets Christians apart from the unbelieving world. So let's read together these words from James chapter 3, beginning in verse 13. Who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your hearts, do not boast and be false to the truth. This is not the wisdom that comes down from above, but is earthly, unspiritual, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there will be disorder and every vile practice. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and insincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. Please pray with me. Father God, we thank you for the gift of your holy word. We thank you that your word is a source of wisdom for all those who are willing to listen to it and to heed its commands. We pray, God, that you would give us understanding now as we examine this portion of your word. I pray, God, that you would guard me from error as I seek to communicate this truth to your people. And we pray, God, that through the preaching of your word, your name would be glorified. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Well, as a young boy, I used to subscribe to Highlights magazine. Every month, I'd look forward to getting the latest issue of Highlights in the mail. One of my favorite sections of the magazine was the comic strip titled Goofus and Gallant. Those were the names of the two main characters of the comic. Two boys who always found themselves in similar situations, but behaved very differently in those situations. Goofus always acted rudely and selfishly, while Gallant always acted virtuously and respectfully. So, for example, in one panel you might see Goofus refusing to share his toys with his friends, while in the next panel you'd see Gallant gladly handing over a toy to one of his friends. Or you might see Goofus throwing rocks at birds, while Gallant is tossing them seeds to feed them. The comic strip is intended to teach fairly simple moral lessons to young children. The point is that you should try to be like Gallant and avoid being like Goofus. Gallant shows us the path of wisdom, while Goofus shows us the path of folly. This is similar to the message of James, except that for James, true wisdom goes deeper than mere outward behavior. True wisdom isn't just a matter of knowing the right things to say and do. We need to start by asking, how should we actually define wisdom? Well, Pastor John Piper describes wisdom as a combination of three things: factual knowledge, situational insight, and necessary resolve. We could use the example of a commander on a battlefield to show how this works. The commander has to have all of the right facts. He has to know the size and strength of both his own troops and the enemy troops. He has to know the terrain of the battlefield. And as the battle unfolds, he has to know how to make real-time decisions in response to enemy tactics and maneuvers. And he also has to have the willingness to make hard decisions, even when that might cost the lives of his own troops. Factual knowledge, situational insight, and necessary resolve. Those are all essential components of wisdom. And yet there's more to it than that, because as James tells us, heavenly wisdom has a sinful counterfeit, a mirror opposite. You see, the enemy commander can have that kind of wisdom too, but this is an earthly wisdom which masquerades as heavenly wisdom. And these two kinds of wisdom are very different in their goal, in their fruits, and in their source. And these are the aspects of wisdom that I'd like to focus on today. So first, with respect to the goal of heavenly wisdom. The Christian life is set apart by a different set of priorities. Our ultimate goal is not material success or comfort or ease of living. Not that such things are wrong in themselves, but they become wrong when they're pursued as our highest aim. Instead, the goal of the Christian life should be obedience to the two great commandments taught by Christ: love of God and love of neighbor. James speaks of the meekness of wisdom, meaning that we are called to a life of humble self-denial. We don't put our own interests first. Our highest aim is to glorify God and to serve our neighbors. I think that the past several days have revealed to all of us just how fragile and unstable worldly comforts can be. The things that we take for granted one day could be gone the next, whether that's our financial investments, or our jobs, or our own health. The circumstances of life can upturn our own expectations without a moment's notice. And those moments of crisis tend to expose the loyalties of our hearts. You could even say that they reveal what we worship. The late American author David Foster Wallace, who was himself not a believer, once said these words: In the day-to-day trenches of adult life, there's actually no such thing as atheism. There's no such thing as not worshiping. Everybody worships. The only choice we get is what to worship. And the compelling reason for maybe choosing some sort of God or spiritual type thing to worship is that pretty much anything else you worship will eat you alive. Now, those are pretty insightful words for a man who did not confess Christ as Lord. The wisdom of the Christian life consists in putting our ultimate hope and trust in one who will not disappoint us. Christ is our solid rock, and all other ground is sinking sand. Any other pretend God or rival object of allegiance will eventually swallow us up. And what's more, giving our ultimate allegiance to any pretend God will lead precisely to the kind of bitter jealousy and selfish ambition that James warns us about. If love of God is not our highest aim, then we cannot truly love our neighbor either. Instead, we'll tend to use our neighbor as a means to achieving those things that we think will bring us lasting satisfaction. If we place upon other people the weight of meeting our deepest longings, longings that only God Himself can fulfill and truly meet, then that expectation will crush both them and us, and it will lead to frustration and division and disorder. That's the bitter fruit of earthly wisdom. But contrast that with the fruits of heavenly wisdom. James says that heavenly wisdom is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. Notice how James's list of the fruits of heavenly wisdom sounds somewhat similar to Paul's list of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5. And yet James's list focuses especially on fruits we demonstrate in how we use our tongue. These fruits are all in opposition to boasting, to strife, falsehood, and any other sins of the tongue. In other words, we can say that the fruits of Christian wisdom are revealed in how we speak to and about our neighbors. James gives himself gives us such an example of wise speech, as we see how he dealt with one of the first major internal crises of the early church. In Acts chapter 15, we read about a division that arose over the question of whether Gentile believers had to become circumcised in order to become full members of the people of God. James spoke out in defense of Christian liberty, while still encouraging Gentile believers to abstain from sexual immorality and the appearance of idolatry. And the result was peace and unity within the church, rather than strife or discord. Now, it's appropriate for us to ask, how can we as Christians make wise use of our tongues? Following James's instruction, we need to consider, how can we use our speech to promote peace rather than discord? That's especially important in a time of crisis like this, when we all want quick answers. We all want to know, how bad is this situation going to get? What will be the ultimate impact on our health and on our economy? How soon before things will start to return to normal? What will normal even look like on the other side of all of this? Amid all of these kinds of questions, it's important as ever to follow Scripture's teaching, to be quick to listen and slow to speak. The reality is that no single person has all the answers to this situation. Now, while it's true, it is our Christian duty to submit to those who are placed in lawful authority over us, and it's important for us to defer to the expertise of those who specialize in these fields of study. We also need to recognize that the politicians don't have all the answers. The economists and epidemiologists don't have all the answers. Your pastors don't have all the answers. When we're in crisis, we're confronted with our own limitations. But recognizing the limitations in our own knowledge is, in fact, the path toward wisdom, because it teaches us to rely less on ourselves and more on the one who is in ultimate control. And the more we rely on the Lord, the more we start to bear the fruit of purity and humility and peace in our lives. Now, the third and final aspect of heavenly wisdom that we'll talk about is its source. Notice that James speaks of Christian wisdom as wisdom from above. That expression, from above, happens to be the same Greek word that Jesus used in his conversation with Nicodemus in John chapter 3. Jesus said to Nicodemus, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot enter the kingdom of God." Now that phrase, born again, could also be translated born from above. The point is that heavenly wisdom, like the spiritual experience of regeneration, isn't something that we can conjure up by our own effort. It doesn't come from within ourselves as if it were a product of our own merit or expertise. It's given to us as a gift by the Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit who transforms our hearts and gives us wisdom and understanding and unites us with Christ and all of his saving benefits. In our own sinful nature, and apart from the regenerating power of the Holy Spirit, we're all worse than sick. We are, in fact, dead in guilt and in corruption, and no one on earth can cure us from this condition. No amount of human expertise or ingenuity can bridge the divide created by our own rebellious hearts. But thankfully, God, in his infinite love for us, doesn't leave us in that condition. He has sent his own Son, Jesus Christ, the great physician of our souls, who experienced the weaknesses and infirmities of this life, and also suffered the scorn and shame of death on a cross, in order to give us eternal life and all of the blessings that flow from it. Heavenly wisdom is in personally knowing and trusting the one who is the source of all of our spiritual blessings, the one who will someday return and abolish sickness and death and bring us into an everlasting kingdom where we can enjoy the fruits of the harvest of righteousness. As we begin to understand that beautiful truth, we begin to grow in true heavenly wisdom. Please pray with me. Lord God, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lived a perfect life on our behalf and suffered the death of a criminal in our place so that our slate could be wiped clean, so that we could stand before you in confidence, not having our own sins counted against us. We thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit, whom you have sent to dwell within our hearts, who applies the saving benefits of Christ to us so that we could walk in newness of life. We pray, God, that through your Spirit you would enable us to grow in wisdom and humility and purity and all the other blessings that are ours through Christ Jesus. We pray, God, that you would help us to walk through this difficult situation, knowing that you are in control of all things. And we pray, Lord, for wisdom as we seek to live out that life on a day-to-day basis. And we pray, God, that through the witness of your people, your name would be glorified. We pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught his disciples to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Well, I pray that you have a blessed week. And as we conclude now, I would like to leave you with these words of blessing, this benediction, which comes from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 23 and 24. "Now may the God of peace himself sanctify you completely, and may your whole spirit and soul and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. He who calls you is faithful. He will surely do it." Amen.